It's been a few months since the last time I took a look at high-end Android hardware, and wow, things have changed. Previously, high-end Android emulation stopped at PS2 and Switch, but we've seen some drastic developments over the last few months. With current-gen flagship Android hardware, it is now possible to emulate PS3, Xbox, Xbox 360, and Wii U to varying degrees of success. That's pretty awesome, and we're going to delve into all of them in greater detail in this video, but there's something even better. I have a secret for you. This is not a cloud game. This 95GB AAA PC title from the end of 2021 is running on this phone. In this deep dive review of the overclocked Snapdragon 8 Gen 3, we're going to go over how all of this is possible. We're going to have a few devices in this video from different manufacturers, but the main one with the highest performance features is an overclocked Snapdragon 8 Gen 3. This phone is the Redmagic 9S Pro, and it has the same specs as the 9 Pro that I reviewed in December, but this one has an overclocked GPU and a prime CPU core. We're going to see exactly what this overclocked chip is capable of, but let's determine exactly how it differs from the normal 8 Gen 3 processor and how it compares in synthetic benchmarks. In front of me, I have the Redmagic 9S Pro, the 9 Pro, and the ROG Phone 8. If we open up Ada 64, we can see that they all share the same CPU configuration, but they don't share the same maximum CPU clocks. When it comes down to the X4 core, we have an overclock at just over 90 MHz. That's not terrible, but the GPU is way more important for what we want to do today. When it comes to that, we have about a 10% overclock. Switching over to synth benchmarks, here are my top CPU scores for Geekbench 6 across all three devices. As you can see, even with an overclock on the CPU core, binning plays a large role when the overclock is relatively small like it is here. I also went ahead and ran the OpenGL and Vulkan tests, and these are the best scores that I got on each device. Our GPU overclock is high enough that it can provide a higher score even if we had a lower binned SoC than the other two. Here's an overview of the 3DMark scores that also prove my point. Since my last video on Snapdragon 8 Gen 3, we've seen a lot of emulators come and go. I'm sure you all know about Citra and Yuzu at this point, as well as Nintendo's whack-a-mole game with all of the Yuzu forks. This hardware was already overkill for PS2, 3DS, and Switch. Thankfully, we have a ton of new things that we can run on this, either natively or via another layer of emulation. The first one ended up coming to us via an unintentional leak. It's not fully fleshed out right now, and there are a lot of things that aren't even supported at all, but Wii U emulation is now possible on Android. So let's just do a quick overview of this. As you can see, we have a list view over here with all of the games that I've been testing. If we go over to the options menu, we can set the games folder, configure buttons, change graphic options, change audio options, add graphics packs, and change the overlay settings. I had some issues with the input options resetting back to default when the emulator was crashing a few times, and that was really the only annoying part about testing this. We don't have a lot of options inside the graphics settings at this point, and we also don't seem to have any audio stretching options in the audio section. They have a graphics pack section, but I've not tried this, and I don't think it's even worth messing around with at this point. Finally, the overlay section has some useful stuff that we can turn on to gauge the performance of the emulation. I have this set to display the FPS in the top corner. Now I'm going to pick a game that has an issue. Here we have Wind Waker HD, and you can see the FPS stats in the corner. We drop down to around 10 FPS in this intro, but this is without the maximum performance possible. If we pull out the menu, you can see that our GPU clock is pretty low. This should be the standard behavior of an Android device unless the app is coded to force max clocks. If we want to get around this, we can just turn on Diablo mode. Anyway, this game is running as you can see, but we can't play it because it requires you to enter a name. The controller doesn't work for this, and neither does the screen. I also connected a keyboard to try and type this out, but that doesn't work either. I could probably bypass this by making a save on a PC, but I don't think it's worth it. Just set your expectations for other games based on how this one is operating. I put together a little showcase of titles that I've tested on this, and I'm going to start with games that don't run at all because there are a lot of them. There's not a lot of commonality between the titles that don't work. Some of the games have input that you can't use, and others just don't work at all. Occasionally, you'll find a game that seems like it would work, but it either fails to fully load or get to a point where you can actually play the game. Let's now look at games that run, and the first game that we have is Shovel Knight. This is a pure 2D game, and it runs very well. I'm just including it here so we can get a full picture of what this can do. Not all 2D games will run this well. This isn't a fully 2D game, and it does run well in the starting area, but later on it slows down when you have monsters on screen. I kind of had to dig deep to find games that would work on this, and I'm kind of surprised by the current state of this emulator. This is performing a lot better than the initial release of some other emulators, even though this isn't an official release. It's just a leak. But yeah, I'll let the rest of this play out. There are a couple of games in here that are performing a lot better than I would expect, and I'm hopeful that those games will run at full speed on this hardware once this emulator is fully fleshed out. I hope we don't need a better processor than an 8 Gen 3 for Wii U emulation.
Up and down. Okay, now try turning left and right.
To do anything further, we need to throw in another layer of emulation so we can run PC applications. This will allow us to run PC emulators and PC games. There's a lot here, so I will probably end up making a full detailed guide on this, but let's just jump right in. For this, we're going to use an app called winlator, and there are a ton of versions of this that have a ton of features. I have three installed on my device, and they all have various pros and cons. Let's go into the first one just to see how it works. So as you can see, I have a couple of containers set up, and these are just individual Windows installations that are set up with the files and configurations needed to run a given game. As you can see, I have one called Skyrim, and that's ready to go for Skyrim. The other two apps are set up like this to run other games with other settings and files. If we go into the Skyrim container settings, you can see my resolution options, my graphics driver, and my DirectX wrapper. I can cover more of this in a detailed guide later on. Let's go into the Resident Evil 2 container to talk more about another point. After the container boots up, you'll have this folder view with several drives. The bad thing about this software at this point in time is that it's not compatible with Steam. If you're someone like me with a huge Steam library, it's time to take a big L. You are either going to have to use GOG releases or even DRM cracks for Steam games. The thing that sucks is that even if those games run on a normal PC, that doesn't mean that they'll run under emulation on this. Anyway, let's launch Resident Evil 2. If I'm lucky, this should just work, and that's a big reason why you want to have separate containers so you never end up breaking a working installation while you're working on another game. For most of what you run on this, you're going to be GPU bottlenecked, which means you're going to want your GPU clock to be as high as possible to get the best frame rate. Right now, I am getting decent performance at around 30 FPS. Resident Evil 4 runs natively on the iPhone at 30 FPS, so this isn't that far off. If you don't have a device like this or a rooted phone, you may not always get the best performance possible even if you have active cooling. Right now, I'm on the balance profile and that's giving me 1 GHz on the GPU, but that isn't common. Usually, I would need to use Ryze or Diablo to get that clock. If we go down to the Eco profile, you can get an idea of how this would perform on a throttled 8 Gen 3 device. The FPS drops significantly. Now, we do have active cooling built into this phone, but it's not powerful enough to be able to cool this device with either of these running at max clocks. With a 1 GHz GPU clock, this thing is going to pump out a ton of heat, so you will need some kind of external cooler when you want a game like this. It's worth pointing out that even with these Peltier coolers, the device will dump more heat than they can handle. You need a pretty hefty cooler if you want to do some serious docked mode gaming on this processor. Now that we have that explanation out of the way, it's time to take a look at some PC emulators running under emulation. The first system that we'll take a look at is the original Xbox with the XMU emulator. This emulator doesn't work that well on this platform, and that's probably due to the fact that it's already running via emulation itself with something called QEMU. Just like Wii U, there are games that don't run at all, games that run at frames per minute, and other games that seem like they would run with no problem, but actually run in slow-mo when they fully boot. I did a video recently on this emulator running on a Nintendo Switch, and the sad thing is I think it even ran better on that than it does here, even though these both have ARM processors, and this one is orders of magnitude more powerful than a Switch. I am hopeful that we will get a native port of this emulator at some point in the future. CXBX Reloaded should run better than XMU since it doesn't run via QEMU, but it failed to boot any game that I tried. That is a bummer. We can also try out Xbox 360 emulation with the PC version of Xenia. Like XMU, some of the games are going to be measured in frames per minute. This is Red Dead Redemption running on this device with the footage sped up by 500%. 007 seemed like it was going to run in single digits based on the intro, but the game crashed when I tried to move the character. That leaves us with PlayStation 3 emulation, and you might think that there's no chance this emulator is going to run at all based on what you just saw. But you would be wrong. It actually runs very well, all things considered. For this, we're going to use the PC version of RPCS3. Let's start off with some emulator inception with Sonic Ultimate Genesis Collection. These are 2D games, and the input lag is pretty extreme, but they do run very well on this. Here's a side-scroller with some 3D elements that also runs very well with this emulator. Let's move on to a heavier title. Here's Demon's Souls running way better than I would expect. There are some audio issues, but damn, this is awesome to see. It wasn't that long ago when PC handheld struggled to run this game. Now we have Android phones that can emulate a PC well enough to run them. It's nuts. The last game that I tested is Bleach. This one lags a bit when there's dialogue on screen, but the performance is not terrible outside of that. In heavy combat, it will drop down to single digits. I still think it's more than impressive for this initial look at PS3 emulation on this hardware.
No need to hold back now.
Let's do this!
So, we've seen PC emulators running under PC emulation, but now it's time to take a look at PC games running under PC emulation. And there is a ton of stuff that runs very well on this hardware, or hardware that is way weaker than this. This is awesome to see. There are a lot of PC games that run well enough with touch controls that I could see this being a reasonable gaming experience for the average person, especially when you consider the current state of mobile games. The one big issue that this has when it comes to a docked experience is that there isn't a good capture of mouse input. In some games, it will cause a lot of issues, and I hope this will be fixed going forward because there are a lot of games that I could see myself playing on the go. I'm gonna switch over to docked mode for the next collection of games because it's easier to manage the cooling of this, and it is also easier to film. Here's Far Cry 1, running at 720p, low settings. It has some graphical issues, and aiming is not that easy due to the mouse capture issue that I just talked about. From here, we have the first three Harry Potter games. These run very well on this hardware, but they don't automatically scale that well with the default resolution options.
Alabama! A chocolate frog.
Let's pick up these birds and ask me. Fred and George will trade some wicked stuff for them at their shop.
From this point on, let's take a look at some newer titles. Here's Skyrim, running at 1080p. Performance is really good in this underground area, so I want to bump this resolution up to 4K just to get an idea of where the limits are. After we do that, we're sitting at around 20fps, which isn't that bad when you consider that this is not a native Android game. This is crazy to see. If we turn these settings back down to 1080p and select Ultra Graphics, that gives us around a console 30, but I don't think this will hold up in the main world. So let's just go back and drop this down to 1080p low and take a look at what this can do. When we finally get outside, we seem to be above 40fps for most of this, which is awesome to see.
Good luck. I wouldn't have made it without your help today.
We're back to Resident Evil 2 again. This game has some input issues when you try to use a controller. Your character will just spin around in circles and you can't walk forward. You also can't shoot. There's a fix for this that allows you to walk forward, but you still can't shoot. I end up running all the way to the station like this, and it's a shame that the input is broken because this game is running very well. Here's Hades 2. This game runs well in terms of performance, but I couldn't get controller support to work. You're limited to mouse input, and the same capture issues play out here. Tomb Raider has a built-in benchmark that we can use, which is good because the game would not load the first level for me. At 1080p low settings, we're getting an average of just under 50 FPS. Not bad. Our next game is a bigger one. Here's Monster Hunter World running at 540p. It doesn't look that great when you're playing this on a monitor, but it's not that bad on a smaller screen. This resolution makes it look like a Vita port. I dropped the resolution down to 540p to make it more playable. I hope this gets to the point where an HN3 can run this game at 60 FPS. That would be awesome.
Be careful.
Fallout 4 is one of the better 3D games that I tested out. Here it is at 720p low settings, and I think this is more than playable.
Hey.
Our last game for this docked mode is Final Fantasy VII Remake. This game runs very well at 720p low settings with an average of 30 FPS or so out of combat. There is a low-end mod for this game that should be able to give us a 20 FPS boost or more based on my experience with it on a very weak PC handheld. I wouldn't be shocked that this game could run above 40 FPS in combat with mods. The only issue that this game has is that the audio doesn't work at all. I'll keep an eye out to see how this performs in the future. Well, we're gonna wrap up this video, but I have two more games that I filmed in handheld mode. I have to say, I am super impressed with the current state of emulation on Android. There was a point when development kind of plateaued right before we got some banger releases with Aether SX2 and Yuzu. Then, development died on both of those, but now we have a completely different direction to take emulation with all of this PC translation software that is being developed for Linux devices and handhelds. On top of that, we have some initial development with Wii U, which is very exciting to see. I think a few months back, we were kind of climbing down from an emulation peak with all of the canceled Android emulation, but it now seems like we're climbing to an even higher peak than any of the ones in the last few years. Based on what I'm seeing here, I think we're about 2 to 3 meaningful Snapdragon generations away from having the gaming performance of a Steam Deck in an Android phone when the Android phone is emulating a PC. I am sure the emulators themselves are going to improve going forward, as are the open source drivers that these Snapdragon chips use, so it's really only a matter of time before an ARM chip can just brute force its way into good PC gaming. My favorite game that I test in this video is Dragon Ball Z Kakarot. The performance is awesome on this chipset, and I didn't have any issues in the game itself. I cannot wait until stuff like this is readily available on Android devices because games like this would mop the floor with the current gacha games that are available on Android these days. Here's hoping it doesn't take that long. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see another, take a look at a video that I did on the Switch Lite in 2024. That device uses some of the same software to run PC games. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.